Ewan, you ready?
Yeah.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
All right. Let me just add to this. This is, he's a legend in Luxembourg. So I'm a Detroit legend. He's a Luxembourg legend.
Like it. So you two have collaborated on the epic new album project, Verses. And we're going to have an album listening party immediately following this Q&A, which is going to be a treat for everybody here. If you're in the vicinity of Work Bar, why not pop on down in a little while and hear this very special album, which the guys are going to talk about just now. First, I was wanting to ask, because the Verses, the project began as a live performance in Paris in 2009, didn't it? What made you want to embark, Carl, on this ambitious project?
Was it 2009 or 2008? I can't remember, but it's been so long ago. Alex Kazak, whose label is Infinite, he and I have known each other for a long time, from when he worked at Warner Music, representing RNS for France. So he was working on my 69 projects and some of the other stuff. And he came to me with Francesco's music and said, you know, there's this new guy. He's incredible. You got to check this out. And he played the bells that Cheech did and Strings of Life. And I knew that it was incredible. Now, I didn't realize that I already met him before. We met each other in Holland somewhere at a gig. He came up with some friends. And then as we got to know each other, Alex made the suggestion that, yeah, we should do this symphony of, you know, my music. My music would be good to do this stuff, and that Francesco would be the man to get involved to arrange it. Because Francesco intimately knows techno music, and I'm glad that it did go that direction, because what happens with a lot of music that comes from electronic music, even with jazz, when you try to convert that music to something in the realm of instrumentation, symphonic instruments, it can get very stiff and rigid, and it can not mesh well at all. One thing that I saw was Yusef Lateef in Detroit playing with the DSO, and it was amazing when it's only him playing with the DSO, but when he had his band playing with the DSO, it was like two different worlds that were colliding. They weren't working together. They were definitely colliding. And with Francesco, and him knowing the music and him being a fan of electronic music, he was able to do things that I definitely couldn't have done, and I think no other arranger could have done that doesn't know the music. So it was really an important key factor to have him at the beginning, and then when the orchestra rehearsed, he was able to say, you know, maybe that's not so good, maybe that's great, oh, it's fantastic, you know, whatever. And I felt comfortable by it, and we could go on to that next step. So really the brainchild of the project was Alex Kazak.
Okay, cool. How much preparation did you do for that gig back then?
I don't know. How much preparation?
I guess we rehearsed for about a week or something with the orchestra. It took me about 3 months to prepare the scores for the orchestra, and probably another month for the parts to be edited and made readable for an orchestra musician. And we put it together in about 3 or 4 rehearsals, 1 week or something.
And then you decided after the show to do an album project.
Yeah, that's right. The performance was incredible. It was something that really, it proved the point. It proved that it could be done and it could be done where it feels like it's a party, not just a performance, a symphonic performance. So if you watch the video, when we do technology, you know, the whole place explodes, and then we do this rendition of the melody, and you know, it just was like really a party with family in the room, 1,000 family members in the room, in this concert space, and you know, the conductor, I mean, the guy was incredible. He was excited about it at the end because I don't think he's ever had a situation where people responded in you know, such a way, you know, because, I mean, I don't know if he ever had gone to Fabric or, you know, Rex Club or anything like that. He's not that much difference in age than I am, I don't think. But I think we did a performance in Milan after that, and he wanted to, you know, he wanted everybody to stand, right? Because he felt that it was going to be, you know, that same kind of party atmosphere, and it felt to me that he was feeding off of it. And then, you know, I'm glad when stuff like that happens. You know?
Yeah, I think he was dancing himself, the conductor, more than maybe towards the beginning of the show, or towards the end of the show, he was out of the box. He couldn't stand still, but. I think for this kind of project, what Carl just said is, if you have a seated concert hall, and by the end of the show everybody's standing and screaming and dancing, that's really something that doesn't happen so often, and when it happens, is quite intense and magical. I recall the first performance as being really special. The second one was more difficult for external reasons, but then we had recorded by then already. We had recorded the orchestra. Yes, we did that shortly after the first session, the first show, and then started the long production limbo, which I guess took about 10 years or 8 years. I mean, we stopped counting.
How did it work between you guys and other musicians when you were collaborating on the album?
The recording sessions were done with the same people who played the show, so they knew what this music was about. And maybe that was a problem because they weren't playing so tight in the recording as they were playing in the show, because they maybe thought it should be more groovy, where in fact it should be exactly in rhythm and exactly metronomical. We had a long editing session, months of editing, just to put the recording straight. And but it did happen, and I think... maybe Carl can say a few words about this. It's a huge team part of the production. Once the recording was done, that was only the first step.
Yeah, you know, there's time that passes with any production that you do, whether it's an album or you know, a movie or whatever. There's time that passes, and we needed time to regroup. We needed time to understand what we had, to get a new light of things. We had, you know, maybe three different people that were doing editing, maybe four different people that edited at some point. And, you know, it was a big learning lesson for me, because I had never done anything like that before, because the objective was to go in and have everything in isolated parts, which is great, you know, when you're working with, you know, like a rock band or something, a jazz band. But we're working with orchestra, it's a little bit different. So we needed to start in a way that made it where the conductor could lead his team. And in order for him to lead his team, he needs to have, you know, a real groove track to it in comparison to him presenting the groove himself. So we had to go back and fix some things and back and forth. And I look at this like a movie, you know, because with a movie, you not only have the director, you have editors, you have the trailer that you see on television is edited by a different person that edited the movie. You know, you probably have 10 different people editing the movie. And, you know, it just took this time for us to get to the point where it sounded as incredible, I feel, as what it did when we were on stage back in 2008, 2009. And I think that we got it.
So were you guys physically always in the same room, or did you do some stuff remotely as well?
You know, this record was recorded all around the world, I would have to say. And so, you know, the core recording was in Paris, but, you know, we did recording in Barcelona, some in Detroit, some in, you know, just everything that we could in order to make it come together to be the perfect project.
Cool. How did you choose which tracks from your immense back catalogue to revisit?
I remember the summer where I was preparing this course, we had a meeting on the coast of Catalonia in a hotel. And there were a few tracks I really wanted to arrange because I thought they were really sounding like an orchestra from the original synth tracks, like the strings, the infamous Carl Craig string sound. Then again, I had just a small string section. We had opted for a larger brass section, a fairly large wind section, but a smaller string section. Technology was always going to be part of it. I think it was the first track I started working on. And then I think you wanted to do Desire for sure, and Atlas. I think I guess it was a mix between the classics, what you call the Carl Craig classics, and maybe a few of my favorites. I really wanted to do Dominance as well. But like I said, I could hear already the orchestra in the tracks. And I think that's one of the reasons why I love Detroit techno, because it is very melodic, in fact. It is very orchestra and just... It's just very musical, so it's not all that difficult to transcribe it, but you have to make it user friendly for the orchestra, because a classical musician doesn't think like a producer. It doesn't think in loops. An orchestra musician hates to play loops, so if you write the same bar any given number over 64, they start getting annoyed because they don't want to play the same stuff over and over. So it was really the main challenge for me was to get the orchestra, each individual orchestra player enthusiastic about this, about playing this music. And
that's the real challenge.
But then I think the feeling I had was that they loved music, in fact, and they were really intrigued, because maybe they didn't know who you were.
But by the end of the process, I think they were singing the songs. They were humming the melodies. And
you know, you could hear them in the rehearsal rooms where, you know, the trumpet's just playing. The solo
or whatever. And it's like, wow.
That's Carl Craig sounding right there.
And you guys also collaborated on some new tracks for the project, haven't you? And as well as a classical influence, there's in parts there's a bit of a jazz influence on a couple of tracks, would you say?
Yeah, fix the mic, and you got a gate on something. What's happening with the mic? Oh yeah, the buzz mic. Buzz mic. Oh, that one's got a gate on it too. It's a little distorted. What was the question?
Jazz.
Jazz is good. jazz. What do you want to know about jazz?
No, just that there's one or two jazzy kind of tracks as well.
I don't do nothing jazzy, man. I'm always real. I don't do anything E. No, I mean, my history with jazz has been trying to engulf myself with the real cats, you know, Marcus Belgrave and Wendell Harrison and Rodney Whitaker, Craig Taborn, and and what I do, there might be some influence from my history with those guys, you know, doing it in our zone orchestra. You know, I don't think there's anything jazz about this record at all. You know, I don't hear it at all. And Calvin Scholler, who's another amazing jazz player who's playing with us in the synth ensemble, you know, the directive is that we don't go jazz. The directive is that we keep it raw, you know. So we try to keep it within the range that is of the music, but that's going to be powerful without doing something that's similar to what we've done, you know, in the past with Inner Zone Orchestra or Tribe, or what else did Kelvin handle with me?
But I can understand you when you say there's something jazzy about it. I think what with Carl is referring is the jazz as a project. But if you say it is very jazzy in a way that you know it leaves a lot of space open for interpretation. Like I could understand why some people would hear something we don't. You know, it's because the spectrum of the sounds is very large. I mean, some tracks are very spacey and synthy. Some tracks are very orchestra and kind of band, big band kind of sound. So I would never undermine someone's opinion, say, oh, well, this sounds like, you know, whatever, jazz, okay, sure. It doesn't sound to me like jazz either, but I could probably understand it.
All things amazingly widescreen and cinematic, isn't it? Then I was wondering if you might kind of move into film soundtracks in the near future.
I think Francesco could probably move into it a little quicker than I can. I'm a little too stubborn. I think I'll get in fights with the director too many times. You know, have to pull out a machete or something. No, I'm from Detroit. I have to pull out a gun. So, but. You know, with this album, you know, I wanted it to have this wide view. Like, you know, when I listened to the final master, I was watching Gravity, because Gravity, the soundtrack, had been a big influence for me. When I saw it in IMAX, I thought it was amazing. You know, Interstellar. There was some good stuff in there, but you know, from back in the day when I first started out with Derek May, we would sit on the floor with all the synthesizers surrounded us, saying, "Yeah, one day we're gonna do the new Blade Runner soundtrack. You know, this is what we're gonna do: soundtracks." But then when you walk into that world of music for hire, it's not the same as sitting around, you know, fantasizing about stuff. It's like, you know, I did this one thing where they say, "Oh, we love Bug in the Basement. We're gonna do something like Bug in the Basement," and then they sent me the visual of it, and it had some rock track in 5/6, and it's like, hold on, what do you want? Do you want Bug in the Basement, or do you want a rock track? Which one do you really want to do? And of course, that didn't work out, and I just got frustrated, and I'm not interested in doing that anymore. But I don't have the musical education I feel to make music on demand like that without having some form of musical inspiration like with what I do with remixes. And Cheech has way more musical education than me, so maybe this could be the direction that he might want to take. What do you think about Cheech?
I think the production of Versus is very cinematic or cinematographic. I was very surprised to hear the last. I told you the last cut, the director's cut, let's call it. And I think there's definitely something like you said, widescreen about it, and it conveys, I think, the image of the orchestra very well. But it's not the typical Hollywood orchestra, cheesy, bombastic sound. I think it's very smartly produced in the sense that you can hear, it's almost as if you could hear the individual players in the orchestra, and to support that there is this huge Hans Zimmer-like orchestra sound to sustain that. And it kind of goes in between, and I think it's very smart. I've done a few musics for film, small productions, short films mostly, and it's a strange world. It's a very strange world, and work for hire is something you have to come to terms with, I would say. But maybe one day we'll meet a director who will say, "I want you to do exactly what you want." I wouldn't exclude it, but not sure if that's around the corner.
And then 9 years later, they'll finally get a soundtrack.
Yeah. Well, I can imagine various tracks getting picked up you guys getting asked if they can use some of your music in a sync for a film or something. Would you agree to that?
Syncing, I have no problem with. Yeah.
But not the changing everything around, that working for hire for a director's specifications is too frustrating a process.
Yeah,
because you're the director.
Maybe because I'm the director. No, I don't think of myself as a musical valet. I'm not, you know, I'm not the dry cleaner of music. So I don't quite get something right. You got to send it back to get the spot out. You know, no, that's not my steez.
You guys are going to be picked out live, aren't you? The Versus Synthesizer Live Ensemble. Have you got a few shows lined up already?
Yeah, it's actually called the Versus Synthesizer Ensemble. I just want to reiterate that, you know, I'm just being me. No, yeah, we're doing Movement as the first show in the May, and we do Sonar. And then we do some other dates that I can't quite remember right now. I just want to get past the first two that can be perfect. And then I think all the other ones will just be more than amazing. But the plan for the show is that when you hear it and you see it again, that you see a show that will be as impactful as the first time that you saw it. You know, that's how I want the show to always be. You know, little changes here and there, but not like a DJ set where you're changing it all the time or something, but more like, yeah, you're watching a movie soundtrack or you're listening to a movie soundtrack, you know, boom, 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 boom. And there'll be little changes in the space or little changes in where it is that makes it maybe more interesting than the last time you heard it. So I think we're doing 10 so far. We have 10 shows. Yeah, so every one of those shows will be even more exciting, if not to you, then to me.
How many musicians are you going to have on stage with you?
The synth ensemble it'll be a total of 6 of us, right? So it's a smaller way to go. When we did Versus with orchestra, there's no going back. You can't do it without having as many pieces as we did. So I felt that it would be a much better idea, and I brought it to Cheech about it, that we do it as a synth ensemble instead. And it makes it an interesting story because, you know, it's us. and it looks like we're going to have some of the baddest-ass players out there. And if they're not badass players, then they might be some of the bad players. But you know, I don't think that's going to be the case.
No, I think the idea to replace the orchestra by a small synth ensemble is brilliant, and I have to credit Carl for that, because the logistics for 40 orchestra musicians is pretty impossible. It excludes immediately large stages, large festivals where you don't have sound check, basically. You come, you play, you go. So, and, you know, 40 plane tickets and stuff. So it makes it really difficult. And I think that's why we only had 2 shows in this setup. And so we were thinking how we could do this. And one idea would have been to reduce the ensemble to do 10 or 12 players. But Carl said, no, let's just do synthesizers. And I think it's brilliant because you can have this impact of the synth sound, of analog synthesis, which is comparable to a large orchestra by the sheer spectrum of frequencies, you know? So I'm very much looking forward to this.
And in a couple of years or something, might you try and do a whole orchestra show again?
Yeah, let's see. Could be something after, you know, the project has evolved into something else. Take it back to the origins, but not repeat what we did. I don't think we would want to do that. Do something else. Maybe with Airborne.
When's the album actually coming out then?
The album comes out in May. May 5th. The album comes out May 5th at an online download retail online streaming service near you. Go to your record store and ask for them to press up some copies for you. I'm sorry, what did you ask me? Oh, the label is Infinite and Planety. But let me tell you a little bit more about this project here. This project comes from my soul, because I always wanted to do music with strings and with orchestra and that kind of stuff from when I was a kid hearing Dionne Warwick records, you know. Yeah, all the strings and stuff, or Ramsey Lewis records, you know, when he would do these kind of jazz remakes of the Beatles and stuff like that. So when the idea of this came up, this was just absolutely perfect. And again, you know, from the beginning with sitting on the floor with synthesizers with Derek May, you know, when we talk about Strings Life, it was always that idea, like, yeah, it's really like Strings Life. You know, Frankie Knuckles gave him that title, which worked out perfectly. So it plays with your imagination that it could be done by orchestra, which he did do with orchestra a couple of times recently, which is great. So all of these things came together in these years of making, you know, music with synthesizers, playing strings on synthesizers, and then, you know, listening back when I was doing the mixes and stuff and hearing, you know, the soundscapes of the strings and how it was arranged to play what I played was just unbelievable. And, you know, it took me a long time I think I might have done 70 mixes of this album or something before I actually got to the end. I mean, I did like tons of mixes of this thing, and every time adding or subtracting or doing something, trying to get it right so that, you know, I felt that people would appreciate it in the same way that I appreciated it with. So this is like seriously a labor of love, you know, for me. And once again, I'm glad to have Francesco involved in the project from the beginning. And, you know, he said that he made the suggestion to do Dominos, and every time I go back to listening to it, that might be the most powerful sounding one on the whole project. So thank you, man. It's amazing. And thank you all for being here. This is you got any more questions for us, or are we gonna listen to the music? Should we listen to the music, y'all? All right. We're gonna listen to the music.
Thanks very much. I'm afraid only the people in this room are going to be able to listen to the music. You at home are going to have to buy the album or come and see one of the shows when they happen. But thanks very much, Carl and Francesco, for coming down today.